scripture reading is from the book of John, chapter 5, verses 1 through 9. After this, there was a festival of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now in Jerusalem by the sheep gate, there was a pool called in Hebrew Bethzatha, which has five porticos. In these lay many invalids, blind, lame, and paralyzed. One man was there who had been ill for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had been there a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. And while I am making my way, someone else steps down ahead of me." Jesus said to him, "Stand up, take your mat, and walk." At once the man was made well, and he took up his mat and began to walk. Now that day was a Sabbath. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Well, today we are in our third week of the sermon series, A Miracle of Faith, looking at the seven miraculous signs that John records in his gospel. Begin, though, by telling you about this little girl. She's 5 years old or so. She's sitting with her mom. Her mom's doing dishes in the kitchen. And she's just watching her mom, staring at her. And finally she says, "Mama, you have a couple of hairs that are white. Why are they white?" She says, "Well, dear, every time you do something wrong or you make me sad, one of my hairs turns white." She pondered that for a little bit. She looked at her mom again and said, "Mommy, why are Grandma's hairs all white?" Sometimes just some little comment runs you right over, doesn't it? Last week, we looked at a gentleman in the Bible story who was having a really bad day, a period of his life, because his son was near death. Today, we're introduced to a different guy who's probably kind of gone unnoticed now. He doesn't really get seen anymore. He has no position, no power, none of that. He's not just had a hard day. He's had a really hard life. For 38 years, he's been hoping for a miracle. He's been relegated to sit next to this pool where people came to cleanse themselves before worship. And he was one of those people that I imagine people have seen so often. They don't even see him anymore. If I were to ask you to describe yourself with one word, what word would you choose? Some of you might choose mother or father, grandparent. Some might say doctor. Some might say caregiver. There's a whole host of names. But then, you know, when you really look at that, it's probably a label, isn't it? Because it wouldn't fully describe who you are. It would just be a label. Now, this guy has been given a label. For 38 years, he's been labeled by his circumstances. How do we know him? What do we call him? The paralyzed man beside the pool. But thankfully, Jesus didn't see a label. Jesus saw a person. And it's important for us to realize Jesus doesn't see our labels. He sees who we are. Jesus did the same thing for Nicodemus and the woman at the well back in chapter 3. But this guy here, he suffered from paralysis. But don't we all, in some way? His was physical. Some people have an emotional paralysis. Can't express themselves or can't do that in kind of an acceptable way. And other people have a relational paralysis. They just can't seem to develop deeper relationships with others. There's so many different ways we have paralysis in our lives. What's your paralysis? Jesus sees more than just this man's ailing body. He sees something deeper. He sees a spiritual ailment as well. this man is ailing because of a couple of false assumptions. One of those is that time has passed him by. Now, roughly the average lifespan around the time of Jesus was somewhere around 37, maybe a little less, maybe a little bit more. And how long has he been ill? 38 years. He's gone past that. He's well past his prime. But Jesus heals him and shows him that Jesus is the master of all time. Time doesn't matter to Jesus. The second assumption I think is false that he was probably operating under is that he had to be the first one in the water to be healed. Now, some lore grew up around that particular pool of water, and it was that whenever the water was stirred, they believed an angel had come and touched the water, and there was healing properties in it. And the first one into the water was the winner. Everybody else, tough luck. Though there's nothing in Scripture anywhere that indicates that would be the case. But that thought, that lure, that maybe even superstition, you'd say, grew up around that. But don't you and I have some superstitions too? We all think we do. We try not to. But baseball fans, you guys are superstitious. And any former baseball players here? You guys are the worst. We all have these things that, you know, if I want my team to win, I've got to eat this for lunch. And I've got to sit here. I've got to be there in front of the TV. Just so as if my being hundreds of miles away doing those things really makes a difference. We're believing in things that really have no power. This man, I think his greatest handicap was believing that God's power was limited. He can't be the first in the water, and so he thinks he'll never be healed. So Jesus asks him a very difficult question. Do you want to be healed? And he's been ailing for how long? 38 years. Don't you find that to be a rather ridiculous question to have to ask? After 38 years, who's going to say no? But I think it's a very important question that Jesus asks. Because you and I all know, too, what Jesus knew. Just because someone needs help doesn't mean they want help. And it's hard to help someone who doesn't want help. Just think of those three crosses on Calvary. There's Jesus in the middle, thieves on either side. One says, help me. Jesus gives him a promise, right? Today you'll be with me in paradise. The other one ridicules Jesus. He didn't want any help. What does he get? Exactly what he wanted. No help at all. He didn't want it. Jesus sees beyond the label of this man, the paralyzed man at the pool. And he sees deeper than that. And he knows what we know to some degree, and that we often succumb to our illnesses. And we succumb to them long before they take their physical toll. We succumb to them mentally, we succumb to them emotionally, we succumb to them spiritually. And we retreat within. And we get further and further away. We get deeper and deeper inside of ourselves, and we demand more and more pity from everybody else. Pretty soon, the whole universe is locked around me. I can see a little bit of that attitude in this man by the way he answers Jesus. This is what he says. Sir, I have no one to put me in the pool when the water is stirred up. And while I'm making my way, someone else steps down ahead of me. It's not unreasonable. He explained the situation. But wouldn't it have been a lot easier to simply say, yeah! Yes, heal me. He doesn't do that. There's that defeat within his answer that we can hear. And his answer demonstrates that he thinks his situation is hopeless. And I can't blame him. It's been 38 years. It's easy, though, to become adjusted to the things in our lives, even when they're not good things. And here is a man who adjusted to life on a 2x4 foot mat. It seems a little ridiculous to us when we think about it, But he's made that adjustment. It's monotonous, but it's safe. It's predictable. As odd as it is, it's comfortable, because he knows it. And we do the same kind of things. Do you want to be made well? What do we say when Jesus asks us that question? Do I want to be made well? Do I want to leave behind the things that are holding me back, that are hindering me? Or am I just become so comfortable with it that it's easier to hold on to it than it is to let go? There's a fear of what's not completely understood in front of me, too great for me just to let go of what I have. Do you want to be made well? If we don't, then we just keep doing everything the same way. If we do, Jesus says we have to take a step of faith. He says to the man, stand up, take your mat, and walk. Call him to do something he had done in 38 years, if ever. Stand, take up your mat, and walk. The life that Jesus offers requires us to see things differently, think differently, act differently, believe differently. We want to repeat history? What do? Just keep doing the same things. If you want to change history, you have to do things that haven't been done. You ever notice that history makers are often rule breakers? Jesus was a history maker. He was a rule breaker. The Pharisees knew that. You know that they put together over time a comprehensive list of religious rules. They called it the mitzvah. There were 613. Have you all memorized 10? How are you going to keep track of 613? 248 were stated in the positive. 365 were in the negative. They were the do-nots. 39 of all those rules related specifically to defining what was work on Sabbath, what you could or couldn't do on the Sabbath. Now here's this man. He gets healed. And I would imagine that he's kind of jumping around and dancing around and having a good time, celebrating the fact that he's been healed. And no one would have had a problem with that. But the moment he picks up his mat, he's done what? He broke the law. He broke the rules. And the Pharisees are going to have a problem with that. The Pharisees, oddly enough, were accusing Jesus of being the rule breaker. When in fact, they are even worse. They are plotting to kill Jesus. Last time I checked, murder was in the top 10. They wanted to kill him. They can't see the miracle right in front of them because all they see is a broken rule. The law was supposed to help guide and direct and even protect the people of God. They've begun to use it like a noose to choke people and hold them down. And it's going to require a different way of looking at things. They see there's first order change and there's second order change. First order change is just doing things differently. Second order change is seeing things differently and responding to that. Albert Einstein once said, the significant problems we face cannot be solved at the same level of thinking we were on when we created them. Makes perfect sense, doesn't it? If I have a certain way of thinking and I've created these issues, if I have the same way of thinking, I'll continue to have the same issues. What does that they also say? The definition of insanity is what? Doing the same thing and expecting different results. It's not looking at simply what can't be done because of what you don't have. It's beginning to see what you have, how to make that work. Jesus, if he were in just simple first order thinking, would have simply moved the guy closer to the water. So the next time the guy saw the water sturdy, he'd just fall into the water and pray that he was first, so he wouldn't drown. But Jesus wasn't using that first order change. He was using the second. He was looking at it differently, forcing everyone else to look at it differently. As I mentioned last week, several decades ago, all we thought we lived in was a four-dimensional world, time, and then the three dimensions of space, right? And then along came Einstein, his general theory of relativity. And said, that's true, but we're also hurtling through space. So this, all of this is relative to everything else that is happening. And now the string theorists say there are 11 dimensions of time and space. And God operates simultaneously and continuously in all of those that we understand and we don't understand. And yet we still try to keep God in our little box. And say, God can only do the things that we can accept and understand. But that's the only space God has to operate. Mark Patterson, in his book, The Grave Robber, once said, half of faith is learning what we don't know. The other half is unlearning what we do know. And the second half is far more difficult than the first. Jesus said it this way, you have heard it said, but I say to you. Remember reading that? Jesus, in computer terms, was uninstalling some old assumptions and installing some new ones. I've got a little task for you as we get ready to close here. You can tell me on the screen here, 9 dots. You see them? Take your finger and close one eye if you need to. However you want to do that. Move your finger with 4 straight lines. Connect all 9 dots without kind of lifting your finger as if it was off the page. Give it a shot. See if you can figure out how to do that. You want to see the solution?
Yeah.
Here it is. Did I cheat?
No.
Why is it wrong? It goes outside the box, doesn't it? It goes outside the pattern. But I never told you you had to stay in the pattern, did I? Why do you think we have to stay inside the pattern? Because that's what we were taught. What's the first thing you learned in kindergarten? Color inside the lines. Okay? I got in trouble. I remember getting in trouble because I didn't like to stay inside the lines. I eventually learned how to do that. But then all the psychological tests told me I had a problem with authority and I didn't want. When we create the boxes and we stay inside the boxes, we try to limit God. We see only possibilities that we can do, and we don't see possibilities God can do. And Jesus himself said, with God, all things are possible. God's not limited by our limitations, and God knows absolutely no statute of limitations about anything. Imagine this man, after 38 years, stands on his feet. His legs are nothing but skin and bone. Firstly, no muscle there. There's no muscle memory. His body doesn't know how to function and balance when he's upright because it hasn't happened in so long. It's impossible. It can't happen. But it does. It says he was made whole. And I can't explain how that is. I can only explain who makes it possible. Because we're more than the labels we put on each other. We are who God tells us we are. And what does God's word tell us as followers of Jesus? Who are we? We are more than conquerors. Paul says we're super conquerors. We're the apple of God's eye. We're the ones that God seeks after. We are joint heirs with Christ. We are children of God and a whole host of other things. But God says, this is who you are when you're one of mine. Sometimes we gotta forget what we think we know and stick with what we know because of who he is. When we know who he is and believe what he says he is, and I know I belong to him, that's what defines who I am. Sometimes I just got to forget all the other stuff. Got to forget the limitations everybody else sticks out there. Follow the one who's not limited. As you receive from the table today, Think about who you are and whose